Welcome to Washington Today on C-SPAN Radio for Wednesday, December 8th, 2021. Senator Kirsten Gillibrand saying the military criminal justice reforms in the new compromise annual defense policy bill do not go far enough. President Joe Biden talking about his video call with the Russian President Vladimir Putin. President Biden ruling out sending U.S. troops to Ukraine if Russia invades that country, but promising tough economic sanctions against Russia. Germany electing a new chancellor for the first time in 16 years. We'll talk with the Wall Street Journal Germany correspondent about the new chancellor, Olaf Scholz, replacing the outgoing chancellor, Angela Merkel. The U.S. Senate poised to vote to overturn President Biden's private employer vaccine mandate with a bipartisan vote. And the CEO of Instagram defending the social media app at a Senate subcommittee against accusations the app is harmful to the mental health and well-being of teenagers. From Stars and Stripes newspaper, military justice reforms included in the final draft of the annual defense bill do not go far enough to provide justice for victims of sex crimes, a group of senators said Wednesday, calling for a Senate vote on legislation that expands the battle against the problem. On Tuesday, top Democrats and Republicans on the Senate and House Armed Services Committees unveiled a compromise 2022 National Defense Authorization Act, or NDAA, that they said they hope can be passed quickly by both chambers of Congress. The House passed the $760 billion bill later that night. That was from Stars and Stripes. Well, now it's over in the Senate, and the senators mentioned in the article holding a news conference led by Kirsten Gillibrand, Democrat from New York.
Under this NDAA, the commander remains the convening authority, a central role to the military justice system. Every single court-martial will still begin with the words, "This court-martial was convened by order of the commander." Commanders can still pick the jury, select the witnesses, grant or deny witness immunity requests, order depositions, and approve the hiring of expert witnesses and consultants. And they can also continue to allow service members accused of crimes the option of separation from service instead of facing court-martial, a total denial of justice. When the commander is so deeply involved in a case, there's no independence for the prosecutor, and there's no perception of independence for the accused or the accuser. Dividing these responsibilities further between the commander and the prosecutor will add layers of bureaucracy, slowing the process down and making it longer for survivors to seek justice and to see justice. These reforms also fail to draw a bright line at all serious non-military crimes. That bright line is critical because it's what helps avoid creating the so-called pink courts, focused solely on sex crimes, which only further stigmatizes survivors, something survivors have specifically asked us to avoid doing. Drawing that bright line also avoids creating an inherent inequality in the military justice system. Every victim and accused offender in these serious cases should be treated equally and have access to a system that is both professional and unbiased. The majority of our colleagues have recognized that. Our bill has the support of a bipartisan, filibuster-proof majority in the Senate and a majority in the House. But the will of those members was ignored in the NDAA, where committee leaders stripped out reforms from the bill behind closed doors, despite assurances that they would follow regular order.
Senator Kirsten Gillibrand at a news conference today. The compromise NDAA removes commanders from prosecuting decisions for 11 crimes, including rape, sexual assault, murder, and kidnapping. Senator Gillibrand wanting that to apply to over 30 crimes that are not unique to the military. As mentioned, this bill passing the U.S. House Tuesday night, the vote was 363-70, bipartisan yes votes. Managing the floor debate, Congressman Adam Smith, a Democrat from Washington State and chair of the Armed Services Committee.
And the single most important thing in this bill, in my view, is we finally reform our military code of justice for how it deals with sexual assault. a stain on the military to this day is the fact that we have not adequately dealt with and protected the service members who have faced sexual crimes in the military. This is the most transformational change that we have done on that issue. We take all sex crimes away from the commander, and we create a special victims prosecutor who will have the expertise, the commitment, and the focus to adequately decide what crimes should be charged and to prosecute those crimes effectively. Now, a lot of people have worked on this. Nobody's done more than Jackie Speer. Jackie is responsible for getting this done and getting it to this point. Of all those people who worked on it, there were a lot of differences of opinion about how exactly to do it. And I know some folks think it should have been done slightly differently here, slightly differently there. This is the agreement that we can get done and get passed. And it is transformational in what it does. It is also, I believe, crucial to dealing with one of the other major issues that we face in the military, and that is diversity. I yield myself an additional minute. The diversity problem that we have with recruitment, promotion, and how is the UCMJ carried out with regard to people of color? This bill will give us the opportunity to set up a whole set of crimes that are under a new authority to take a shot at fixing that problem. Now, I know some would like to add more crimes to that, and we had that debate. This is what we came up with, and it is huge.
Congressman Adam Smith, chair of the Armed Services Committee, on the House floor Tuesday night before the House passed the National Defense Authorization Act and sent it to the Senate. Connor O'Brien is a defense reporter with Politico, and he joins us now with more on this bill. Let's begin with that military criminal justice reform provision. What happened between the House and the Senate?
Yeah, well, Senator Kirsten Gillibrand has been pushing for almost a decade now for an expansive reform of the military justice system, particularly to tackle sexual assault in the ranks, but to address other issues such as, you know, racial bias in the application of military law. What she proposed was taking all of the felonies, the major crimes, out of commanders' hands and giving them to independent prosecutors. That was included in the Senate bill. She had garnered, I think, about two-thirds of the Senate co-sponsoring her bill and was able to get that into the defense bill. The House didn't include it. It had a more limited provision that was limited more to sexual assault, sex crimes. And the final bill basically hewed more to the House side to what the Pentagon actually had preferred. It takes the prosecution of these sex crimes and other related crimes such as murder, kidnapping, outside of the chain of command, gives them to special prosecutors. That obviously has not sat well. Senator Gillibrand, who appears ready to oppose the bill, and probably I would assume seek another vote on her measure on the floor because she has a supermajority. And others have opposed as well. Anthony Brown in the House, because this change, he argues, isn't going to solve the issue of application racial bias in the justice system. But advocates have said this is a watershed moment, so milestone change for how the military handles sexual assault.
What about the overall spending? As I understand it, it's actually more than what President Biden proposed.
Yes, it is. Well, and that's a bipartisan rebuke of President Biden's first defense budget. The Biden administration proposed $715 billion for the Pentagon this year. While that's an increase from the last budget that was locked in during Donald Trump's term, the criticism is it's effectively flat with inflation, actually maybe even a little bit of a haircut. Particularly Republicans have been arguing for months that more was needed to kind of reorient the military toward the challenges that are posed by Russia and China after 20 years in the Middle East and Afghanistan. And so there need to be these investments in new technologies, in shifting for resources to the Indo-Pacific, that sort of thing. So what we saw was both the House and Senate Armed Services Committee, strong bipartisan majorities, endorsed a $25 billion increase to the Pentagon budget to about $740 billion. Now, I think it's important to note that the defense authorization bill is just that. It's a policy bill. It doesn't actually appropriate money. So lawmakers are going to have to get a funding deal for the full fiscal year for that to become a reality. But, you know, still a bipartisan rebuke of the president's first defense budget.
We're talking with Connor O'Brien, reporter with Politico. What other major provisions of this bill have you been following?
Well, there are a number of big policy debates that were kind of hashed out in this bill. You know, as far as Russia and China are concerned, the lawmakers landed on a $7 billion fund to beef up the U.S. military posture in the Pacific region. $2 billion more than what the Biden administration had requested. There's $300 million in there for Ukraine, which is a $50 million increase from the administration's request, and they set aside a certain percentage of that money for defensive weapons for Ukraine. The lawmakers had it out over several other issues. Extremism in the military, the House bill pursued an office of countering extremism in the Pentagon, but Republicans were ultimately successful in getting that out of the final bill. And then another major provision that was kind of a stunning turnaround, frankly, was the provision to expand the registration for Selective Service, require women to register for a military draft. That was in both the House and the Senate defense bills with strong bipartisan support. And I know, frankly, I was surprised. A lot of people were surprised when it came out of the final deal. And that was obviously a sticking point for a lot of conservatives like Josh Hawley, who fought to get that out. Jim Inhofe, the ranking member of Senate Armed Services, fought to get that out. And you heard a lot of Republicans touting that as a victory for conservatives. And frankly, Republicans, moreover, have been kind of hyping the stuff pushed by Democrats that they were able to get out, such as the extremism, expanding the draft, and similar measures.
Connor O'Brien covers defense policy for Politico. Read his stories at politico.com. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
This from NBC News. President Joe Biden said Wednesday that he was not considering unilaterally sending U.S. troops to Ukraine, a day after he met virtually with Russian President Vladimir Putin. In a roughly two-hour call on Tuesday, Biden warned Putin that Russia would face severe economic sanctions if it invaded Ukraine. Biden also informed Putin that the U.S. would provide additional defense materials to Ukraine and build up military capabilities in nearby countries that also border Russia. Putin has moved more than 90,000 troops to the Ukrainian border in recent weeks. That from NBC News. President Biden speaking today with reporters outside the White House.
The meeting with Putin, I was very straightforward. There were no minced words. It was polite, but I made it very clear. If in fact he invades Ukraine, there will be severe consequences. Economic consequences like none he's ever seen or ever have been seen in terms of being imposed. He knows his immediate response was he understood that, and I indicated I knew he would respond. But beyond that, if in fact we would probably also be required to reinforce our presence in NATO countries to reassure particularly those in the Eastern Front. In addition to that, I made it clear that we would provide the defensive capability to the Ukrainians as well. The positive news is that thus far our teams have been in constant contact. We hope by Friday we're going to be able to say and announce to you that we're having meetings at a higher level, not just with us, but with at least four of our major NATO allies and Russia to discuss the future of Russia's concerns relative to NATO writ large and whether or not we can work out any accommodations as it relates to bringing down the temperature along the eastern front.
Can we rule out troops on the ground, sir, putting U.S. troops on the ground?
Yes, in terms of in Ukraine.
And Senator Tim Kaine, Democrat, talking about could U.S. troops be needed on the ground in or around Ukraine to stop an invasion? Will you rule that out, or is that on the table?
That is not on the table. What is not a, they are not. We have a moral obligation and a legal obligation to our NATO allies. If they were to attack under Article 5, it's a sacred obligation. That obligation does not extend to NATO, I mean to Ukraine, but it would depend upon what the rest of the NATO countries were willing to do as well. But the idea the United States is going to unilaterally use force to confront Russia invading Ukraine is not on the, in the cards right now. But what will happen is there will be severe consequences that will have.
Sir, you've known Vladimir Putin for years. Are you confident that he got the message and knows this is different?
I am absolutely confident he got the message.
President Biden with reporters outside the White House before he left. You could hear the helicopter Marine One in the background. The Kremlin, writes the Washington Post, expects a swift start to U.S.-Russia talks on the confrontation over Ukraine after President Biden and President Vladimir Putin both accused the other of military escalation in the region. Putin on Wednesday called the video link talks with Biden open, substantive, and constructive. Putin said, "We can continue this dialogue. It seems to me that's the main thing." That was from the Washington Post. From the Wall Street Journal, Germany's parliament elected Olaf Scholz, 63 years old, chancellor on Wednesday, ending Angela Merkel's 16-year rule. The country's new center-left leader inherits longstanding challenges from his predecessor and faces a cluster of short-term crises that could complicate his plans to modernize the German state and its economy. We'll talk with the reporter who wrote that article in just a moment, but first, reaction to the election from the deputy White House press secretary, Karine Jean-Pierre, traveling with the president on Air Force One.
Germany has a new chancellor today. Does the president plan to meet Olaf Scholz soon? And if he does, how confident is the president that Germany would support strong sanctions against Nord Stream 2?
So for the first part of your question, President Biden thanks former Chancellor Merkel for her many years of leadership and extends the congratulations to Germany's new chancellor. And the president is looking forward to building on the strong ties between our two nations and working closely together to make progress on today's global challenges. The president looks forward to speaking with the chancellor, but I don't have any specific call to review. And on your other question, So we have had extensive conversations with incoming and outgoing German administrations as it relates to Nord Stream 2, right? That's the question you were asking, in the context of a potential Russian invasion. But I'm not going to get into private diplomatic discussions other than to say this is an important priority for the Biden administration. As you all know, we are continuing to work with Germany to implement the July 21st joint statement of the United States and Germany on support for Ukraine, energy security, and other climate goals. And I point you to the clear commitments our countries made in the joint statement to take action if Russia attempts to use energy as a weapon or commit further aggressive acts against Ukraine.
Deputy White House Press Secretary Karine Jean-Pierre speaking with reporters while traveling on Air Force One. Bojan Panchevsky is the Germany correspondent for the Wall Street Journal, and he joins us now from Germany. Thank you very much for being with us. Who is Olaf Scholz?
Well, Olaf Scholz is now the new Chancellor of Germany. After 16 years of Angela Merkel, the Germans have a new leader. He's a social democrat, which means he's sort of left-leaning, left of the center. And he will take over, he has taken over the helm of Europe's biggest economy and the European Union's most populous state at a time of a sort of great crisis in terms of COVID, in terms of geopolitical developments around Europe. So it's going to be a very interesting time to watch Germany kind of develop under this new leadership.
How might relations with the U.S. evolve? Will there be any changes?
Well, you know, foreign policy is always very constant, I think, in most countries. And Olaf Scholz has already said a number of times, including today and yesterday, that German foreign policy means continuity. He basically said that the United States is one of the key partners of Germany in Europe. He said NATO, the Transatlantic Alliance, is the kind of bedrock of German geopolitics. So not much will change in that regard. However, you know, times are changing and there is a growing rivalry between Washington and Beijing, between the United States and China. And I think increasingly, this started under President Trump, but it has continued under President Biden. The United States is wanting European allies to position themselves in this kind of standoff. And I think that Olaf Scholz has intimated that he's not interested in taking positions in that regard. So it's likely that Germany will find itself between the two superpowers.
Was it a contested election at all, or more of an anointment?
The election today was just a formality because basically Olaf Scholz has got a coalition of three parties, his Social Democrats, left of center, the Greens, an environmentalist group, and the Free Democrats, a pro-market party, and they kind of hammered out a coalition agreement. So today's vote in parliament was just a pure formality. And as to the election in September, it came as a bit of a surprise to some that Olaf Scholz ended up winning the election because he was the underdog originally, but he ran a pretty good campaign and he sort of was seen as a steady, safe pair of hands in a time of turmoil.
16 years is a long time for having one leader, Angela Merkel. What's the feeling there about this transition?
Well, you know, it's very interesting because, you know, there are voters, there are young voters who through all their adult lives have only known one chancellor, Angela Merkel. And so it's quite a change. It's quite a change for Germany. It's quite a shift in society to have this kind of towering figure that people got used to being present at all times, guiding them through crises and so on, is now stepping down. So it's I think for many, it's a sentimental moment. For others, you know, it's the opposite. They're quite happy to see her go because 16 years is a good old time. You know, it's very unusual for Western leaders to be around for that long. And it's going to be interesting time. But I think the transition is very smooth because you know, you have to know that Olaf Scholz was vice chancellor to Chancellor Merkel because she ruled for the most time in power. She ruled in a coalition. You see, Germany is always run by coalitions. Unlike in the United States, two or more parties have to get together to form a government here. And Angela Merkel ruled, her conservatives ruled with Olaf Scholz, Social Democrats, for the most of her reign. And in the last 4 years, he was finance minister and chancellor. So people are used to him. They know that he's capable of handling a high office of state. And, you know, he's got a reputation for being steady and sort of performing in high office. And prior to that, he was also a government minister in 2009. And in the interim, he was the mayor of Hamburg, which is a pretty important city. It's a trading hub in Western Germany. And so he's quite a popular politician overall and well-known, I think, to the German electorate.
And finally, what's the number one issue that he will need to address in the short term?
It's really difficult to say because, you know, he's got a very bold agenda himself and his government. He wants to reform the economy. He wants to overhaul the German industry. He wants to make it greener. He wants to make it decarbonized. He wants to make it fit for the 21st century. He wants to digitize the public administration. He's got a bold vision for a number of issues, but as usual, events basically overtake and kind of mess up all the plans of politicians. I think the primary task for the moment is handling the pandemic here in Germany. We are having the greatest ever sort of wave of infections of COVID-19 to date in the past since the epidemic started. So it's a pretty testing time to take charge of the country, and I think that will be the primary task. And then there is a plethora of other challenges coming. The inflation is rising here. There is a geopolitical tension with Russia amassing troops along the Ukrainian border, which is not very far from here. And Germany buys energy from Russia. It buys gas. It has just built a new pipeline, which will channel gas, will double the exports of Russian gas directly to Germany. And that's it's a very awkward moment to be happening. So there are a number of economic, healthcare challenges, governance, geopolitical tests. So there's plenty of things that he will need to be confronting in the immediate term.
Bojan Panchevsky is the Germany correspondent for The Wall Street Journal, joining us from Germany. Thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.
This is Washington Today. From CNN, the U.S. House Select Committee investigating the January 6th riot informed Mark Meadows that they have no choice but to advance criminal contempt proceedings against him, given that former President Donald Trump's former chief of staff has decided to no longer cooperate with the panel. That's according to a new letter sent from the Select Committee chair, Benny Thompson, Democrat from Mississippi, to Mark Meadows' attorney. The letter was dated on December 7th, released today. Congressman Pete Aguilar is a member of the Select Committee. He's a Democrat from California, asked today about Meadows and other potential witnesses not cooperating.
We heard that the criminal referrals were meant in part to deter others from stonewalling. Given the fact that after Steve Bannon, we've had Jeffrey Clark not exactly compliant, and now you have Mark Meadows, does it show that deterrence part is not actually working?
No, I'd reject that completely. We've heard from a number of the attorneys of individuals who we have spoken to, clearly. We've heard from some counsel that have said specifically, my client is not Steve Bannon. And so, we know that this is something that individuals don't take lightly, and clearly their counsel doesn't take it lightly. Like I said, over 270 witnesses who have come forward, and we continue to gather information. It is an incredibly small number of individuals who have indicated they're going to claim privilege or otherwise stonewall our efforts, and they will have consequences to those actions. But we continue to gather information, as evidenced by the chairman's letter to Mr. Meadows' attorney that was released this morning.
Congressman Pete Aguilar, member of the Select Committee investigating January 6th attack on the U.S. Capitol. He's also vice chair of the House Democratic Caucus at a news conference today in Washington. From Politico, they write, Mark Meadows, facing an imminent threat of criminal contempt of Congress charges, is suing Speaker Nancy Pelosi and members of the January 6th Select Committee. Former White House Chief of Staff has filed legal action against Pelosi, according to court records. As the January 6th Select panel prepares to take action against him, Meadows has claimed he can't discuss matters that could be covered by executive privilege. You can read more at Politico.com. Congresswoman Ayanna Pressley, Democrat from Massachusetts, has introduced a resolution to take away committee assignments from Congresswoman Lauren Boebert, Republican from Colorado, for, as Pressley says, repeatedly making anti-Muslim remarks aimed at Congresswoman Ilhan Omar, Democrat from Minnesota. Recent video shows Boebert comparing Omar to a suicide bomber. Congresswoman Pressley spoke today at a news conference.
For a member of Congress to repeatedly and unapologetically use hateful, racist, and Islamophobic tropes towards a Muslim colleague is dangerous. This sort of toxic behavior has no place in the halls of Congress, and it diminishes the honor of the institution that we all serve in. It has no place in our public discourse. It has no place in our society. It has no place in any workplace, period. Over the last week, we have seen a growing coalition of lawmakers call for real, meaningful accountability for Rep. Boebert's actions. When we asked for an apology and acknowledgement of her racist and blatantly false comments, we were met with even more racism and bigotry. When we called on Republican leader McCarthy to hold this member of his caucus accountable, we were met with defiance and gaslighting. Enough is enough. Each day that passes without meaningful accountability, we risk normalizing this behavior and endangering the lives of our Muslim colleagues, Muslim staff, and every Muslim who calls this country home. And despite what some may argue, this is not about any one member of Congress. This is about accountability. This is about protecting the integrity of the House of Representatives and about living up to the very values that we espouse and claim to represent. Many of us here today witnessed firsthand the consequences of the previous president's rhetoric when he incited a mob of violent insurrectionists to attack our seat of government. We have heard the hate and credible threats that have been directed at Rep. Omar and her staff. Words have consequences. We must acknowledge that and respond with action. We've introduced this resolution today to do just that and to send a powerful message to every Muslim and every marginalized person who has ever questioned their place in this country or in the halls of power. We see you. You belong, you are powerful, and you deserve a life free from fear and filled with dignity and love.
Congresswoman Ayanna Pressley with reporters on Capitol Hill. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, Democrat from California, asked at her own news conference today about when the full House might act against Congresswoman Boebert.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Congresswoman Omar said after the two of you had a conversation that she was confident that you would take decisive action this coming week. Mm-hmm. What action was promised, if any, to Congresswoman Omar, and are you expecting to take any action against Congresswoman Boebert?
When I'm ready to announce that, I'll let you know. Yes, sir.
That's House Speaker Nancy Pelosi. At a separate news conference, House Minority Whip Steve Scalise, Republican from Louisiana, asked about his own views of the remarks from Republican Congresswoman Lauren Boebert.
Congressman Scalise, do you believe that Representative Boebert's Islamophobic comments about Representative Omar were wrong?
Well, first of all, if you look at what Lauren Boebert said, she came back and apologized. And I do think this gets lost too often because we've had members on both sides that have said things that we disagree with. I don't know if I've seen a time where a Democrat's apologized for their statement. Lauren apologized for what she said. And the fact that on the Democrat side, they want to only go after Republicans, they don't even ask their own members to apologize for things that were said, let alone go after their members. They want it to be a one-sided thing. And I think that's I think that hypocrity is showing. So let them call out what they see wrong, as we do. But when a member apologizes, I think you ought to respect and appreciate that and ultimately call for a higher standard. But it starts with the members themselves acknowledging if they said something that they shouldn't have, to come and apologize for it and then move on.
Congressman Steve Scalise, the minority whip, at a news conference. So far this year, two Republican members of Congress have been stripped of their committee assignments for what the Democratic majority voted to say was inciting violence. Those two are Marjorie Taylor Greene of Georgia, Paul Gosar of Arizona. Washington Today continues in a minute.
C-SPAN offers a variety of podcasts that have something for every listener. Weekdays, Washington Today gives you the latest from the nation's capital. And every week, Book Notes Plus has in-depth interviews with writers about their latest works. While The Weekly uses audio from our immense archive to look at how issues of the day developed over years. And our occasional series, Talking With, features extensive conversations with historians about their lives and work. Many of our television programs are also available as podcasts. You can find them all on the C-SPAN Now mobile app or wherever you get your podcasts.
Welcome back to Washington Today. Again, available as a podcast on the C-SPAN Now mobile app and wherever you get your podcasts. This from the Hill newspaper. The Senate is expected to vote as soon as Wednesday to nullify President Biden's vaccine mandate for large employers, giving Republicans a big symbolic victory. Republicans say they expect the resolution will pass with at least 52 votes after centrist Senators Joe Manchin, Democrat of West Virginia and John Tester, Democrat from Montana, announced their support for the proposal. Every single Republican senator will vote for it. The Congressional Review Act, which was enacted in 1996, sets up a fast-track process in the Senate that allows the minority party to force a vote on a resolution to disapprove of a federal rule. That was from The Hill. The Senate Republican leader Mitch McConnell previewing the vote on the Senate floor Wednesday morning.
For the past 2 years, as the country has battled COVID-19, I've been a strong and consistent advocate of following the science and taking precautions. That's included strong support for the safe and effective vaccines that have helped millions of Americans substantially lower their risk of death or serious illness. I took advantage of these modern medical miracles as soon as I could. I've received a booster. I've encouraged Kentuckians and all Americans to take full advantage as well. I've recorded public service announcements. I'm a survivor of childhood polio. I've watched vaccines obliterate polio in our entire country in my lifetime. Trust me, there's no bigger proponent of vaccination than I am. But here's the thing. The United States of America is a free country. The federal government, elites in Washington, cannot micromanage citizens' personal choices without a legitimate basis in law and the Constitution. And that goes double for presidents going far beyond the bounds of their office and their authority. President Biden's absurd private sector vaccine mandate is blatant overreach. It is illegal. The administration has already lost in federal court and had it blocked. Washington Democrats have lashed themselves to a mast that is very simple. Unvaccinated people should be fired. That's what they want.
The Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell, Republican from Kentucky, on the Senate floor. After the resolution nullifying the private sector vaccine mandate passes the Senate, as expected, then it'll be sent to the House, and it's up to the House Speaker there as to when it comes to the floor for a vote. There's no fast-track procedure. But even if it passes both the House and the Senate, the resolution will most certainly be vetoed by President Biden. That means to overturn the vaccine mandate will require a two-thirds veto override vote in Congress. President Biden today commenting on news from Pfizer and BioNTech that three doses of their COVID-19 vaccine is much more effective against the Omicron variant. It increases neutralizing antibodies by 25-fold compared with two doses, strengthening the case for and the need for booster shots.
I have some good news this morning. The Pfizer lab report came back saying that the expectation is that the existing vaccines protect against Omicron, but if you get the booster, you're really in good shape. And so that's very encouraging news. There's more. That's the lab report. That's the lab report. There's more study going on. But that's very, very encouraging.
That's President Biden with reporters outside the White House. Pfizer and BioNTech also saying development of an Omicron-specific vaccine is moving along and is expected to be available by March of 2022 if an adaptation like that ends up being needed. President Biden left the White House today and went to Kansas City, Missouri, touring a Kansas City Area Transportation Authority facility and talking about the recently enacted infrastructure spending bill, over $1 trillion, and making the case again for the larger social spending and climate programs bill, almost $2 trillion. The House has passed a version of that. The Senate will be taking it up soon. Here's the president.
There's so much we can do. So many things that are within our power. If you went to the average American family making 60 to 70 grand, or you went to a family where dad was a teacher and mom was a police officer, they're making 120, they're paying at a higher tax rate than someone making $1 trillion. I mean, $1 billion. For real. How can that be fair? Look, one of the reasons I feel so firmly in the proposals is because I know what this country can be. We've always been a nation of possibilities. We didn't become this nation by thinking small. We've always thought big. Throughout our history, We've emerged from crisis by investing in ourselves, in our people. During the Civil War, before it was over, Lincoln started to build the Transcontinental Railroad. It was built at the end of and during the Civil War. During the Cold War, Eisenhower built the interstate highway system, transforming the way Americans lived. And now we're at work beginning and building an economy of the 21st century to build a better America. I truly believe, and I promise you this, I believe that 50 years from now, when historians look back on this moment, they're going to say this was the moment that America won the competition for the 21st century. Think about it. Most of you who are over 40 remember us always having the number one infrastructure in the world, the most best education, et cetera. We rank now number 8 in the world in terms of investment, research and development, 14th in infrastructure, the United States of America. And if you're a businessman out there, or you work, or you're a labor, a union person working for business, where's the business going to go? Where they can get the products to market fastest, safest, where they have access to get in and out, where they have access to move. That's why we're losing. That's why we're losing. But we're not going to lose anymore. I promise you. The time of losing is over. It's over, 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 over. God bless you all. And may God protect our troops. Thank you for your patience. I appreciate it. Thank you.
President Joe Biden at a public transportation facility in Kansas City, Missouri today. On Wall Street, the Dow was up 35, NASDAQ up 100, S&P up 14. This from the New York Times. Adam Mosseri, the head of Instagram, is appearing before a Senate panel on Wednesday afternoon to defend the social media app from growing bipartisan outrage over its reported harms to young users. It is Mr. Mosseri's first appearance before Congress. He is the highest-ranking official from Meta, the company formerly known as Facebook and the parent company of Instagram, to testify to lawmakers after a whistleblower leaked internal research that said Instagram had a toxic effect on some teenagers. C-SPAN covered this hearing. Here is part of Adam Mosseri's opening statement.
I firmly believe that Instagram and that the internet more broadly can be a positive force in young people's lives. I'm inspired every day by teens on Instagram, and I'm proud that our platform is a place where they can spend time with the people that they care about, where they can start incredible movements, where they can find new interests, where they can even turn a passion into a business. I also know that sometimes young people can come to Instagram dealing with difficult things in their lives. I believe that Instagram can help in those critical moments. That's one of the things that our research has shown, and to me, this is the most important work that we can do. Taking on complex issues like bullying and social comparison and making changes. Now, I recognize that many in this room have deep reservations about our company, but I want to assure you that we do have the same goal. We all want teens to be safe online.
Instagram CEO Adam Mosseri. Ahead of today's Senate hearing, the company announcing some changes to its app designed to increase safety, including offering take-a-break reminders if you've been scrolling too long, controls for parents to curb their children's usage, and limits on tagging or mentioning teen users. Here's some of the questioning today. Senator Richard Blumenthal, Democrat from Connecticut, is the subcommittee chair.
Instagram is addicted. That's the view that has been repeated again and again and again by people who are expert in this field. Parents know it, and for teens who see Instagram's algorithms encouraging, for example, eating disorders, they find it almost impossible to stop. The UK code restricts Instagram's use of addictive design, legally restricts its use of addictive design. Shouldn't we have a similar rule in the United States?
Senator, respectfully, I don't believe the research suggests that our products are addictive. Research actually shows that on 11 of 12 difficult issues that teens face, teens are struggling, said Instagram helps more than harms. Now, we always care about how people feel about their experiences on our platform, and it's my responsibility as the head of Instagram to do everything I can to help keep people safe, and we're going to continue to do so.
We can debate the meaning of the word addictive. But the fact is that teens who go to the platform find it difficult, maybe sometimes impossible, to stop. And part of the reason is that more content is driven to them to keep them on the site, to aggravate the emotions that are so seductive and ultimately addictive. The UK recognizes it by imposing that design restriction. The same ought to be done in the United States. Let me ask you, will you commit to make the pause on Instagram Kids permanent? In other words, stop developing a site for an app for children under 13.
Senator, the idea of building a version of Instagram for 10 to 12-year-olds was trying to solve a problem. The idea being that we know that 10 to 12-year-olds are online, they want to use platforms like Instagram, and it's difficult for companies like ours to verify age for those that are so young they don't yet have an ID. The hope was to always, or the plan was to always make sure that no child between 10 and 12 had access to any version of Instagram, even one that was designed for them, without their parents' consent. And so what I can commit to today is that no child between the ages of 10 and 12, should we ever manage to build Instagram for 10 to 12-year-olds, will have access to that without their explicit parental consent.
Instagram CEO Adam Mosseri, questioned by Senator Richard Blumenthal. He chairs the Commerce Subcommittee on Consumer Protection. You can find today's hearing in its entirety at our video library, cspan.org. From Yahoo News, out of Great Britain, a senior conservative MP has warned the public are less likely to follow new COVID rules following the number 10 Christmas party scandal. There are concerns that footage showing number 10 staff joking about an alleged Christmas party on December 18th, while London was under strict Tier 3 lockdown rules, meant the public are less likely to follow the new rules announced by Prime Minister Boris Johnson. Number 10, referring to 10 Downing Street, where the Prime Minister's residence is. This scandal was the top subject during Prime Minister's questions in the British House of Commons. Here is Prime Minister Boris Johnson, leader of the Conservatives, questioned by the main opposition leader, Keir Starmer, of the Labour Party.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I heard what the Prime Minister said at the beginning of this session, but frankly, it raises more questions than answers. Last week, I asked the Prime Minister, was there a Christmas party in Downing Street for dozens of people on December the 18th? The Prime Minister, the government, spent the week telling the British public there was no party. All guidance was followed completely. Millions of people now think the Prime Minister was taking them for fools, hear, hear, and that they were lied to. Hear. They're right, aren't they? Hear.
Mr. Speaker, I think the Right Honourable Gentleman probably missed what I said at the beginning, but I apologise. I apologise for the impression that has been given that staff in Downing Street take this less than seriously. I'm sickened myself and furious about that. But I repeat what I have said to him, that I have been repeatedly assured that the rules,
were not broken. Order.
And
right. Well, let's just do a little less, Prime Minister. It's important.
I asked the Cabinet Secretary to investigate exactly what happened, and I repeat that there will be consequences for those involved if those rules were broken, Mr. Speaker.
British Prime Minister Boris Johnson questioned by Keir Starmer, leader of the main opposition party, the Labour Party. Prime Minister's question time in the British House of Commons in London today. ABC News says that Boris Johnson is facing calls to resign over these reports that members of his staff attended a Christmas party last year while the country was in lockdown. Thanks for joining us today on Washington Today. For more top Washington stories, subscribe to C-SPAN's evening newsletter Word for Word at c-span.org/connect. Have a good night.
C-SPAN's Washington Journal. Every day we're taking your calls live on the air on the news of the day, and we'll discuss policy issues that impact you. Coming up Thursday morning, we'll talk about the life and legacy of former Senator Bob Dole with Republican Iowa Senator Chuck Grassley, then a preview of the memorial service at the Capitol for Senator Dole with Brian Lowry of McClatchy Newspapers. And the American leader's David Hawkins talks about the influence Bob Dole had on the Senate and the Senate's to-do list before the end of the year. Also, Kentucky Democratic Congressman John Yarmuth, chair of the House Budget Committee, shares the congressional action on the debt limit and COVID vaccine mandates. Watch Washington Journal live at 7 Eastern Thursday morning on C-SPAN or on C-SPAN Now, our new mobile app. Join the discussion with your phone calls, Facebook comments, text messages, and tweets.